section of our notes from Unit 6. Please be sure to watch the entire video. It's about 13 minutes long. It'll be important to write down what is on this presentation, but equally important will be to listen to the explanations, as that will be quizzed with the pop quiz. It's not important to write down what is spoken, but just to be cognitively aware of what is presented. As you can see, this is a time period after the Civil War for about 50 years when America will become industrialized. We're going to be looking at inventions, innovations, and steel in the first section. This time period is known as the Golden Age, or the Gilded Age, mind you. It's the American Industrial Revolution, in which mass fortunes were gained by few entrepreneurs due to capitalism. Capitalism is the economic system at that time period, where there is less government control of the economy and more opportunities for people to make money. These entrepreneurs are oftentimes people that are inventing things, but an entrepreneur is anybody that's starting their own company. It's anybody that creates their own business, and capitalism would be the economic system that allows entrepreneurs to create their own businesses. This time period, 90% of the nation's wealth was owned by 10% of the population. So you can, as you can see right here, there's going to be a big economic barrier between the rich and the poor. There's only going to be about 10% of the population that is going to be entrepreneurs and going to be becoming rich and wealthy during this time period. Well, 90% of the nation is going to feel a little bit of frustration as they are not making as much money as the 10%. They will be benefiting from the inventions and innovations of the entrepreneurs. So it's kind of a mixed blessing there. But at the same time, they're going to feel like they are not a part of this opportunity that capitalism presents. Electricity will be harnessed in 1878. It was not created in 1878. It was created in Genesis 1:1 when God created light and such. And so 1878 was when electricity was first harnessed. The light bulb would then be created in 1879. And if you can give a guess of who created the light bulb, I'm sure most of you guys can remember that. It would be Thomas Edison. Now, he's not the first one to create the light bulb, but he's the first one to create a successful light bulb. There was a lot of other inventors that tried to create a light bulb, but it wasn't long-lasting. So he's the one that's attributed that. Thomas Edison, he created many patents. I believe it's over 1,000 patents and inventions that he made, but the light bulb would become the most famous. The light bulb would become important because, as well as electricity, because power and light is provided for further distances and longer productivity. So people are able to work for longer hours in the night, not just when the daylight is out. They're also able to work in remote areas instead of needing to be next to a river where there is water power in that capacity. The telephone would be created in 1876. The telephone was created by you-know-who. Yes, Alexander Graham Bell, also known as Santa Claus to his children during Christmas time, I'm sure. Alexander Graham Bell was the famous man for creating the telephone. Now, you might wonder, why is the telephone significant? It's significant because communication became more efficient, reliable, and popular. If you remember, the two modes of communication before this was the Pony Express through letters and also the telegraph through a system of dots and dashes over a wire. Those were not as quick and not as reliable. The telephone, the two-way telephone becomes a lot more efficient and helpful at this time period. We also have the electric sewing machine that will be created. Singer will be the most famous electric sewing machine, but the first person to create it would be Elias Howe. Elias Howe is creating the sewing machine, which is keeping America in competition with the English textile mills. Textiles, as you remember, are fabrics, so shirts, cloth, fabric, things of that nature. England is the economic giant at this time, and so America is able to compete with them through this electric sewing machine. Henry Ford is famous for creating, you guessed it, the car. Now, he's not the first one that creates the car. He's the one that creates the most efficient car, the car that is the most affordable. He was famous for saying that you can have any color of car as long as it's black, because black was the cheapest color at the time, so that shows us that the color of the car being black was a popular car to have because it was cheap. It was a cheap car to have because of the color. The first automobile manufacturer was actually from Germany, Benz, when we get Mercedes-Benz. That was the first automobile manufactured. But Henry Ford would create the most successful car, an efficient car. He would create this by creating the assembly line. He's not the first one to create the assembly line, but again, he makes it the most influential and efficient assembly line. And the assembly line makes products quicker and better quality products. This is important because if you could imagine one person making one product, that would be an artisan. If an artisan, a skilled artisan, was creating a product, let's say an automobile, it would take him about a year long to create the entire automobile. He would not be an expert at individual parts of the automobile, but would create the entire thing. Whereas if you have an assembly line, it creates the product a lot quicker, such as the automobile. If one person's working on the wheels, one person's working on the steering wheel, one person is working on the lights, one person is working on the engine, one person on the transmission, you have each person an expert at the different parts of the car, and the car is being able to be quicker produced and better quality. The unfortunate thing with the assembly line, however, is that the employees make the same piece all day long, and so the work becomes very rote and routine. And so some of these factory workers would actually go mentally insane. If you can imagine, instead of going to different classes, if you have only one class each day for an entire year, let's say it's history class for, let's say, 7 hours a day, and all you did was take notes, the same notes on the same content over and over again, it would become very rote, and you might go crazy. More crazy than you already are in school. As you can see right here, skyscrapers will become very important and a symbol of this Gilded Age time period. That's the Chrysler Building right there. That building would not be created until the 1930s, but still it is a symbol of this time period where steel is being created. Steel would be the important thing manufactured during this time period. Though steel had been used throughout history, the new increased way that steel is being able to be harvested and manufactured is notable during this time period. So steel is fueling the growth of construction. No longer are developers needing to have land to develop, and now they can develop upwards. This is really changing American cities. So now there's more space that's being able to be used by building up instead of just outward. As you can see right here, the New York skyscraper, the Empire State Building would become another symbol. This would not be created until the 1930s, but definitely a symbol of the steel being used. Taller buildings, profit for developers. There's a lot more profit if you can build up versus just out. Another example of steel structures would be the Brooklyn Bridge, as you can see right here. Built in 1883, it was the largest suspension bridge at its time. I believe the largest suspension bridge right now is in Japan, but at that time it was the Brooklyn Bridge. If you've ever been to the Brooklyn Bridge, you know that it connects New York City to Manhattan in Brooklyn. So important bridge there for commerce. The Flatiron Building would also be a symbol of these steel structures. As you can see, kind of an optical illusion there. It looks like it's going to tip over. But because of the steel, it's a lot stronger. And also, if you look on the side, it's a lot wider there, that Flatiron Building. We're going to be looking at another section, industrialization, social theories, and applied Darwinism. This is the last section of these notes. Social theories, gospel of wealth. This gospel of wealth was the idea that hard work and perseverance leads to wealth. This idea that if you work really hard, you will make money. Though this general principle is true, there are some problems with this. We do see this theory alive today. Many of your parents kind of give you this theory that if you get good grades and work hard in school, you'll go to a good college. If you go to a good college, you'll get a good job. If you get a good job, then you'll have a happy life and happy wife and all of that. We know that that is all not true, that oftentimes more money means more problems. And we know that Jesus Christ is the only one that can give us true lasting wealth, spiritual wealth, wealth that lasts, not the temporal wealth. But during this economic capitalist system, it's this idea of good work ethic gives you more money. And though this is generally a true principle, we know that there are obstacles that can create some barriers. Social Darwinism was also another theory at this time period that was implied by these industrialists. This was the idea that the human race evolves only through competition. So just like scientific Darwinism, the theory of scientific Darwinism, if it's applied to socially, it's this idea that as the human race evolves, competition drives that. So the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, which was an idea that Charles Darwin had in social Darwinism. Eugenics movement is this applied social Darwinism, the idea to improve the genetic features, certain races, by selective breeding and sterilization. Now, as you can see right here, this has a lot of racial undertones to it, that the races that are desired will continue to breed, the races that are undesired will be limited. And so this does become a racist movement to make people that have the good genes and the wealthy, which is usually the Northern European, then being able to produce more children, whereas the other races that were more of the working class, the poorer class, not being able to. And this movement actually would not go away, but would continue throughout U.S. history, unfortunately, as many people would become sterilized without their knowledge. As you can see here, not only Carnegie and Rockefeller were actually behind this movement, but actually Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger, she saw birth control and abortions as a means to prevent unwanted children from being born into disadvantaged lives. So as you can see right here, she believed that poor people should not have babies. She believed that poor people should have abortions, should use birth control, because they will raise poor children, if you will. This would create the organization Planned Parenthood that still exists today. Very unfortunate movement that still is being used today to encourage those who are underprivileged, less money, lower income gap, to have less children instead of allowing people to choose themselves. It's this movement to reduce the family and to see children as a problem and a burden instead of as a blessing. It's very unfortunate because for those who are poor, they can be rich through having children instead of being poor by not having children at all either. So this is the end of the notes. What you need to do right here is you need to review through your notes, the two sections. You need to place big ideas on the left-hand side of your notes as you review these notes. And then at the very end, you need to create a one-sentence summary that kind of encapsulates the entirety of the notes. Be sure not to look at the individual features, but to look at the whole summary, if you will. Instead of the trees in the forest, make sure that you look at the entirety of the forest and not be caught up by the individual issues there, the individual content, but to look at it as a summary. Be sure to do that, and I will be stamping that these notes and making sure that you've done them. Also, there will be a quiz on these notes. Thank you.